Толка была в поле.
Все.
Отправились. Пикчерс. Рошовью. Ван Мур. Сойца. Поле вот. Напомню. Вот Сандис. Так. Позвался. Грейт. Тревелла. Мені Джоні, мослі імпольор, пад на полка. So, I will speak about the vortices, the subject in which we introduced a lot of original results. So let us start. I will speak about half-quantum vortices. So it's some exotic creature which was discovered recently in strontium ruginate and in exciton gas in water condensate materials. So let me explain what is going on here. So if we discuss a superfluid which consists of mixture of so-called equal state pairing superfluid, so we have a part of liquid paired with skin up and another part of liquid paired with skin down, each has their own phase factor. So actually one can rewrite this this order parameter of such a liquid like a product of orbital part and spin part. So it's just equally one can rewrite this expression like this, simple algebraic transformation. So you see this is a product of this psi orbital and psi spin. And what is the one quantum vortex? This is a vortex, then we go around this vortex line along the closed path gamma. So the phase of both of this condensate changes on 2 pi. So in this case you see due to these expressions that the orbital part returned back to its value but changing along this contour, but the skin part completely constant because the changes of both phases produce nothing here. What is quantum vortex? Half quantum vortex. This is a situation when the phase of each condensate change one phase doesn't change, another phase change on 2 pi. So you have a vortex, usual vortex in only in one condensate. So but if you look on this combination, the sign of the orbital part of order parameter change sign and spin part of order parameter change also sign such that the product of them doesn't change the sign. So you see the necessary condition to obtain the half quantum vortices. Half quantum vortices, it's just a separable order parameter. When you have the product of 2 paths. So actually where we can expect to find such a situation. First of all, supercritical free, I will explain how it's possible here. When part of my talk will be about the so-called polar phase, in strontium ruthenate it was discovered already and published 3 years ago, and exciton polariton condensate also it's discovered by the product of two parts of order parameter looks like as follows, because it's a light actually, and light has a polarization phase factor of a wave function. So the polarization can change the direction or to the opposite when you go around the vortex, and the phase factor change on pi, so it also change the sign. So the total product of these two part of order parameter keep the same sign. So there's a similar situation possible in charge density wave, spin density wave, Kuldeferian-Larkin Ovchinnikov state, and in supersolid, because in this case there is a modulation of density with phase, and also because it's a quantum crystal, there is a phase factor, and here you have a half declination, if you like, dislocation, if you like, and here you have a change of sign when you go around. But still, as far as I know, this situation not yet discovered. Maybe Brazovsky correct me, but I don't know exactly. Okay. But here you see where I said exactly that. So this situation already discovered. So now about helium 3A. So helium 3A in rotating vessel and filled by the array of vortices. So here the order parameter is product of spin path and orbital path. Orbital path is just this triad of vectors d to prime and L. L is parallel to direction of orbital momentum of Cooper pair. Here is a p-wave pairing, because you see it's linear in k. So, and spin part described by this vector v, because actually you see this direction of quantization, it's a vector actually, and I should put here index alpha, because it's a vector, and one can equivalently describe this combination. This combination like V vector, this one. So it's unit vector. So then you go around this vortex orbital path, orbital path of order parameters can change the sign on on pi, and spin path of order parameter can change sign also changing by pi, changed by pi. So, but there is some disadvantage here, some obstacle, because there is so-called spin orbital cauldron, this other parameter, with two indices, it's alpha and pi. This is a spin orbital interaction in such a type of liquid. So one can calculate this product and obtain this is a constant of dipole interaction. And you see the energetically profitable situation when V, vector V, spin vector V parallel to orbital momentum of orbital direction of orbital momentum. So due to this reason, at distances from the vortex core larger than so-called dipole length, the direction of L vector and V vector should be parallel. So, and it means that we have no distribution, continuous distribution in whole volume. In whole volume, we have just homogeneous distribution of superfluid texture. And but on the other hand, there is a domain wall. which with n on the vortex core with thickness of psi dipole, and due to this reason, the energy of this vortex. So let me return back. I forgot to say about this here. So the gradient energy looks like as follows. Order parameter here. So and if you calculate for a such distribution the gradient energy, you obtain the energy of one vortex in logarithmic approximation. It's a combination of these coefficients and logarithm of distance between vortices, Rv, which is determined by just angular velocity of vessel in equilibrium. Gamma is circulation quantum in superfluid helium free. And the energy of liquid due to appearance of vortices is just an energy of one vortex times the density of vortices. Density of vortices is just determined by the distance between them and distance between and determined by angular velocity of rotation. So actually, it means that if you consider situation if with spin orbital coupling, this calculation of energy is valid only till to the distances from the vortex core smaller than dipole length. After, you have an energy not a continuous distribution of order parameter, but energy of domain wall. And this is not logarithmic, this is a linear function. So it means that if you calculate the energy of the 2n vortices, half quantum vortices, 2n because to imitate rotation with angle, given angular velocity, you need twice more half quantum vortices than single quantum vortices. So this energy coincides with energy of when you fill the vessel by single quantum vortices, only to till to the distances psi dipole. After, you have extra energy due to appearance of these domain walls. It means that always we have such an equality. The energy of vessel filled by half quantum vortices larger than energy of of vessel filled by single quantum vortices. So it's an obstacle which not yet overcame. And in superfluid helium free, nobody seen these vortices.
Is it possible to produce somehow artificially by hand magic angle to exclude spin orbit?
No.
To apply
here, no. But actually, it was proposed by Gregory and Marty Salama. That if we put the liquid between the in flat geometry between the, in slots distance between the walls smaller than dipole length, in this case both for half quantum and single quantum vortices we can forget about spin orbital coupling, and in this case due to boundary conditions orbital momentum perpendicular to the walls, v vector which is always perpendicular to magnetization, and it means perpendicular to external magnetic field, we can and start to rotate such a geometry filled by helium free A, we can expect to find half quantum vortices, but till now this main attempt to find them was not successful. So another possibility, such a possibility actually was realized in strontium ruthenate. Strontium ruthenate, people believe this is a superconductor, p-wave superconductor with structure of A-phase, it's tetrahedral material. Other parameter looks like a product of orbital part and spin part again. And estimation of dipole length or spin orbital length here 50 microns. So it means that if we deal with with specimen of with size much smaller than this length, we can forget about the fixation of the vector in space. And in this case, we can believe that one can create half quantum vortices. Actually, it was done as follows. So it was a superconducting ring with scale about 2 or even smaller, about 1 micron. So under magnetic field, which is perpendicular to this surface of this ring, so this case one can calculate a supercurrent, and this supercurrent looks like it's follows. So lambda is one integration depth. It's a gradient of phase, vector potential. So if you integrate, as usual, this current along the contour inside of this ring, we obtain quantized path. So, but due to the nanoscale, this device, which is much smaller than Lambda penetration depth, we should take into account also this flux, and this combination is known as called a fluxoid. So and so this fluxoid is not quantized now, but quantized with accuracy of this of this torque. So if you calculate magnetic moment of this ring under magnetic field, you obtain due to this formula so quantized part due to penetration of vortices inside of this ring, and this Meissner part due to this guy. So actually it was done and measured, of course. So because minus sign here is Meissner term, always negative, you have magnetic moment depending on external magnetic field as follows. And one can calculate the lower critical field. Of course, it's not the same as for a bulk material. For a ring, ring geometry looks like as follows. And in given case, it's just equal to 8 Gauss, and indeed, at each there are steps in dependence of this magnetization due to penetration of vortices on this plot. So, and this jumps has a following order. Measured. Now, of course, it was measured its cantilever, and actually, this magnetic moment was measured because it's a cantilever due to deviation of this cantilever from exactly horizontal direction, one can measure this wave. So now, what is going on when we applied magnetic field not only along z direction, perpendicular to the ring, but parallel to the ring? This case, there is another lower critical field, which is 250 Gauss for this direction. And we found that starting from, roughly speaking, 80 Gauss, each step split to 2. Exactly the value of when this jumps, one half smaller than the initial jump in absence of Hx. So they claim that they found half quantum vortices, and for me the main proof of this fact looks like as follows. If we have half quantum vortices, the distribution of a spin vector v in this ring should be inhomogeneous, like this. So here is x-axis you see in plane of ring, z direction is perpendicular to the ring. So one can calculate spin current. So spin current is as usual superfluid current proportional to gradient of this phase of rotation of this v vector. So one can calculate magnetic moment along x direction by usual electrodynamic formula, and you immediately obtain this value, which is 2 orders of magnitude smaller than this one. So and it was measured, and it's exactly like this. So one can believe that in this case, of course, it's not a proof that we obtain other parameter, sorry, like in A phase, because you see I not fixed the exact exact form of orbital path of other parameter. In principle, one need to have only separable of order parameter, not obligatory A phase. So now let's look on our possibility. There is another phase, not A phase, so-called polar phase. In this case, other parameter again separable, it's product of spin and orbital path. Looks like as follows. Instead of complex combination which exists in A state, here in polar state it's just real vector. So other parameter is product spin vector and real vector. So, and distribution of mass, if you like, or density inside of Cooper Park pair looks like as follows. So in principle, one can, so if you calculate the spin orbital coupling in this case, you obtain that this is a product V times P square and V and P here. So you see the minimum of this spin orbital coupling when V perpendicular to P. So, and in this case, one can, if you apply magnetic field along P, in this case, one can expect that you can rotate freely this vector V in Basel plane, and there is no obstacle to obtain half quantum vortices. So, and in this case, there is no domain wall at all, and the energy in logarithmic approximation of n single quantum vortices and 2n half quantum vortices, roughly speaking, coincide in logarithmic approximation. Of course, one needs to calculate it more exactly out of logarithmic approximation, but anyway, it's difficult to produce, but better to check it experimentally. But actually, question where to find this polar phase, because I remind you that the phase diagram of superfluid helium free looks like as follows. So you see here you have a phase transition line. So it's 2.5 mK, roughly speaking. It's pressure 35 bar above of which you have a solid. So here you have normal liquid, normal Fermi liquid. So here A phase in this triangle. And inside of this big area, it's a B phase, but there is no polar phase at all. So, but actually already about, I don't know, 20 years, people work with superfluid helium free in so-called aerogel. Aerogel, it's just such a poor structure containing of just sand. It's a sand strands with thickness very small thickness couple of angstrom and distance between them of an order of a coherence length in superfluid helium free. So and they such aerogel imitate impurities. And one can study influence of impurities on superfluidity due to this structure found and produced about 20 years ago. So, and there were performed many experiments, and Osherov, the same Osherov who discovered superfluidity helium free, he found that in presence of aerogel, a phase diagram looks like as follows. This, there is suppression of these triangles. It's a phase transition from normal to superfluid state. In aerogel, there is suppression of critical temperature, first of all. Still, you have B phase here, and A phase now in more narrow triangle. Here, but there is no polar phase at all. So it was done by means of NMR measurements, because NMR can distinguish between normal state, D phase, and A phase. So, but in this situation, typical for so-called isotropic regime, because in isotropic regime, these impurities suppress the critical temperature in the same manner for all different P wave pair. So the suppression of has this following order: psi is coherent length, delta is the thickness of average strand, and Xa so-called distance between them, or correlation length in average. So, but this situation not valid if you have anisotropic aerogel. In anisotropic aerogel, which was introduced actually in practice by Volodya Dmitriev from Kapitsa Institute, instead of isotropic aerogel, he discussed so-called pneumatically ordered aerogel consisting of such a threads oriented almost perfectly parallel at macroscopic distances, about a couple of millimeters. So this is a typical thickness. This aerogel produced by some military team in Obninsk due to their reason, I don't know, but Volodya succeeded to find them, and now he has many samples of such aerogel. So what is going on in this case? In this case, let us introduce in free energy, besides of this suppression of critical temperature, of critical temperature, there is an anisotropic term described by this traceless tensor, and in this case there is a difference of suppression of critical temperature because interaction of other parameter with anisotropic tensor give you different results. For instance, for B phase other parameter is just rotation matrix. If you substitute this rotation matrix here, you obtain nothing. So this anisotropic energy gives you zero. But in A phase, when eta, this coefficient here may be positive, may be negative. Depending on boundary conditions, actually. So if you substitute A phase like this, in this case, you substitute and you obtain this, that the critical temperature for A phase starts to be larger, because you see eta is negative. If eta positive, in this case, if you substitute the order parameter as follows for A phase in our texture of A phase with L vector distributed in basal plane of this aerogel, you obtain that critical temperature also increases, because now it is positive. But if you substitute polar phase order parameter, you obtain even larger increase in comparison with this A phase. So it means that in pneumatically ordered aerogel, phase transition should be first in polar state. So, the phase diagram was calculated numerically by these two Japanese, Ayama and Ikeda. And for negative order parameter, we found that we still have a phase after the phase transition. This is a dotted line, it's just a phase diagram without aerogel, but in presence of anisotropic aerogel with eta negative, here A phase, here B phase. But if eta positive, we found that in narrow region between A phase and normal state, there is a polar state, according to just argumentation which I said. So similar situation actually was discussed theoretically and found experimentally in such a six sublattice antiferromagnet cesium nickel chloride, which has a similar order parameter, not of course not superfluid but magnetic. And first of all, there is a phase transition to the spins distributed in basal plane of his hexagonal material. But after, you have a second order phase transition at zero magnetic field, of course. When the spin starts to be out of basal plane, and it was discovered experimentally. So let us discuss what. If you just return back, if you discuss the situation here, almost neglect anisotropy, in this case the region of polar state will be quite narrow. So let's forget for a moment about this and substitute the a phase order parameter in our formula. One can find the equilibrium value of order parameter of this a state and the increase of critical temperature. Now, I lost one slide maybe. Yes. No. Here. So. Let's now find the order parameters and this and critical temperature not numerically as was done by Japanese but analytically. So for this case, one need to discuss the free energy consisting of five terms of fourth order. So consider the general so-called axipolar state. You see, if you forget about this part of order parameter, you obtain exactly polar state. If you consider just this part of order parameter, you obtain a pure A phase. If you consider both of them, it's a so-called axipolar phase. So let's substitute this order parameter here, just calculate this summation, and obtain the condensate energy like this. So notation here is just beta 1, 2, it's beta here is coefficient in front of fourth order terms. And this is a notation for these betas. And we obtain the first transition to the polar state at this critical temperature. And the value of this A coefficient here, like this, of course, the usual mean field expression, B equal to 0. When you have a second order phase transition, as follows. So, and distance between them, there is a distance between these two critical temperature and both of these phase transitions of the second order. Now, as I said, if we forget about anisotropy, we obtain just pure A phase. We fall in modulus and critical temperature. So now, how to distinguish experimentally between these situations? So it was usually made by means of nuclear magnetic resonance. And you know that in normal fluid, there is under magnetic field, there is Larmor precession of spin around the direction of magnetic field with Larmor frequency, which is just gamma H. Gamma is the magnetic ratio in helium. But in superfluid helium, there is a shift from this frequency. And this expression exactly for shift found by Igor Fomin 30 years ago. So, and of course, this shift expressed through the spin orbital couple. Here, chi is a susceptibility gamma in the magnetic ratio, and this is the derivative of this spin orbital coupling in respect to cosine beta. And beta, you see, it's in this geometry, nu is the end of. angle between the direction of magnetic field and some axis of anisotropy or rotation of this cryostat. And beta is so-called tipping angle, between the direction of magnetic field and magnetization. In NMR, in pulse NMR, one can create any beta, actually. You can create magnetization in pulse NMR between the direction of external magnetic field and direction of magnetization. So if you substitute the other parameter, which I you can calculate this dipole energy here and as follows. So and V vector always perpendicular to S. So one can calculate this dipole energy. Dipole energy and spin orbital energy. So in spin orbital coupling, you remember, looks like this follows. In an anisotropic case, there is additional term. And if you substitute equatorial state inside of this expression, one can calculate spin orbital coupling. And spin orbital coupling for V vector, which is the S vector, as you remember, precess around the direction of external field. But V vector precess around the direction of magnetization. So, if you substitute this expression in spin orbital coupling, you obtain this formula dependent on mu angle and beta. How many? Two. Okay, and in this case, the shift, one can calculate shift for polar state, for pure polar state, looks like as follows. So, there is a difference between two situations. One situation, one V vector is constant in space, it's the case when you have a liquid at rest or single quantum vortices. In case of single quantum vortices, spin part of other parameter homogeneous. In this case, the minimum of this expression corresponds to phi angle equal to zero. So it looks like as follows. One can differentiate it in respect of cosine beta. You obtain the NMR shift like this. But if you have half quantum vortices, you should average this expression because you have space in homogeneous distribution of phi in space. And in this case, the shift looks like as follows. So now about the experiment. Experimentally, one can calculate this shift and compare this shift with shift in pure A phase. If you calculate this shift in polar state should be 4 over 3 shift in A state. So it was measured by Dmitry, and he found that this formula at big enough temperature interval exactly corresponds to this. So actually, this is a discovery of polar state in pneumatical order energy. Now, about this slope change. Slope change, there is a second phase transition to the exipolar state here, and one can find this this change of slope also from the formula above and compare with Dmitriev finding. So it's roughly speaking corresponds to B. So let me finish. Okay. So let me conclude that actually to measure and to find the vortices and superfluids was proposed by Gregory and Kore about 30 years ago. So they predict existence of single quantum vortices in rotating liquid, two quantum vortices, even vortices sheets and half quantum vortices, but till now we not discovered. So, due to the appearance of this polar state discovered recently, I expect in a couple of years we shall obtain the half quantum vortices in polar state.
Okay. So, one, two very short questions. Okay.
So, have I understood correctly that this half quantum and single quantum vortices in the experiment can be distinguished from this dependence of the frequency shift on tipping angle?
Yes.
So it was so fast in the end that I didn't get how big is the difference actually. Is it experimentally very significantly different?
No, look, it's different dependence. For single single quantum vortices, this shift looks like as follows. For half quantum vortices, looks like as follows. So, because you know, Dmitriev measured without rotation, of course, he measured. He found all the dependences from beta and mu, and in the same manner, one can do it here.
Okay. More questions? Last question.
You described helium in aerogel as if its order parameter was homogeneous. But what is the influence of this order on order parameter?
No, for polar state it's true, it's homogeneous, it's not necessary to explain this. But for A phase, it's so-called Imre-Mass state, and I it was mentioned on slide, but I not concentrate your attention on this point. But actually, there is inhomogeneity for distribution of L vector and Basel plane for A phase, but the results not dependent. So we have the averaging over this inhomogeneity obtain this formula which I showed you.
Okay. Let us thank the speaker again. Now, the next speaker is Misha Skvortsov. So.